Welcome students to the lecture series on design of rolling element bearings part 1. In this part we will be discussing about the meaning of bearing, the function of a bearing, then broader classification of the bearings and also the classification of the rolling element bearings, then nomenclature of the rolling element bearings, materials used for the rolling element bearings, the failure of a rolling element bearing, the specification of the bearings, choosing a suitable bearing for a suitable application, advantages and disadvantages of the rolling element bearings, and finally the lubrication of a rolling element bearing. Students, a bearing is a machine element which supports another moving machine element known as shaft. It permits, means bearing permits, a relative motion between the contact surfaces of the members while carrying the load. So the meaning of bearing itself is bear, take up or support. So in this figure, this is the shaft which is mounted on these two bearings, left hand side bearing and the right hand side bearing, and the shaft carries a central load on it. And as a result, there are reactions at the two bearings. Now, as mentioned in this definition, these two bearings will allow the shaft to rotate while carrying the load. Means these bearings act as supporting elements and also at the same time allow the member, that is shaft, to rotate in them. Now, if you look at the classification of the bearings broadly, there are two types of bearings. First broad type is the sliding bearing, also called as sliding contact bearing. In the sliding contact bearing, they have surface contact and are coming under lower kinematic pairs, because we know that whenever there is the surface or the area contact, that pair is known as lower kinematic pair. So under sliding contact bearings, the first type is the radial bearing. The load is perpendicular to the axis or along the radial direction, and there is surface contact between the bearing and the rotating shaft, and here there is axial load coming on the bearing. That is why it is called as thrust or axial bearing, and in this case both loads are there, the axial and the radial loads, and also there is surface or area contact between the rotating shaft and this bearing member. So this is the bearing here, this is the bearing here, and this is the fixed element is the bearing. One is this one. And second category of bearings are called as the rolling contact bearings or rolling element bearings. So in this, as there is surface to surface contact, initially the friction is more, and as the speed goes on increasing, the magnitude of the friction goes on decreasing. Here the nature of the contact is either of line or point, hence they form a higher pair. Means a ball rolls as well as a roller also rolls. That is why these are called as rolling contact bearings. Rolling element means ball or the roller. They are rolling in the races here, the outer race and the inner race. In the rolling contact bearings, we have radial bearings, under that ball bearing and roller bearing. Under ball bearing, single row deep groove ball bearing, single row angular contact bearing, and unit bearing, single row unit bearing, double row angular contact bearing, double row self-aligning ball bearing, single row deep groove ball bearing, single row angular contact bearing, and unit bearing, double row angular contact bearing, and self-aligning double row ball bearing. In roller bearing, we have cylindrical roller bearing. So this is the cylinder, here it is ball bearing, here it is roller bearing. tapered roller bearing. Instead of straight, it is tapered roller. Needle roller, a small sized needle roller. Double row cylindrical roller bearing. This is the figure. Spherical roller bearing, double row. This is the figure. Double row, tapered roller bearing. This is the figure. So this is the classification of the rolling element bearing. And the second category in case of the rolling contact bearings are the thrust bearing, which take up the axle of the thrust load, means along the axis. So the line of the action of load is along this direction. In the case, it is in the radial direction. Again, in the thrust, we have ball thrust bearings and roller thrust bearings, and these are different types of ball thrust bearings and the roller thrust bearings, and the corresponding figures are shown here. And this slide shows the photographs of actual photographs of different types of bearings. The single row deep groove ball bearing, double row deep groove ball bearing, single row roller bearing, double row roller bearing, single row tapered roller bearing, double row tapered roller bearing, double row spherical roller bearing. See the shape of the roller here, it is spherical. Then single row angular contact ball bearing, angular contact ball bearing, double row angular contact ball bearing, needle. This is also a roller, but the diameter is very very small, that is why it is needle. And these are all thrust bearings. These two are the ball thrust bearings, so the load direction will be like this, and the roller thrust bearing. Now coming to the nomenclature of the bearing, this figure shows the pictorial view of a ball bearing. This is the outer ring, this is the inner ring, and this groove, which is all along the circumference, is called as the outer race or outer ring ball race, and this is inner race because it is in the inner ring, also called as inner ring ball race. And this is a retainer. Retainer is used to retain the balls in the position. And this dimension is very important, the bore of the bearing, in bore diameter of the bearing. So here the shaft fits. Okay, this size is equal to the shaft diameter, right? And the bearing is mostly specified by this diameter, and this is the outside diameter of the bearing. Now the different materials used for either the roller ball bearings are the chrome steel SA52100 material. This is having excellent wear resistant characteristics. They are capable of withstanding the temperature up to 120 degrees centigrade, and if heat rated, they can withstand the temperatures as high as 220 degrees centigrade. And second material used for the rolling contact bearings is stainless steel AISI440C. So here slightly the chromium content is increased, that is up to 18%, and hence these bearings made up of stainless steel AISI440 are more resistant to corrosion, and also they are capable of operating at a temperature as high as 250 degree centigrade. Now coming to the failure of the rolling element bearings, how the rolling element bearings fail. If sufficient clean lubricant is provided, failure in rolling bearings will be by surface fatigue. Underline surface fatigue. What is surface fatigue? Surface fatigue means either the surface of this ball or roller, or surface of the outer race, or surface of the inner race will receive small pits, micro pits, because of the repetition of the loads coming on those elements. Fatigue means repetition of the loads coming on those surfaces. Failure is considered to occur when either raceway, either means either the outer raceway or inner raceway, this way, outer raceway, inner raceway, or balls or rollers exhibit the first pit. Pit means sometimes it is very very small, but it is capable of generating some amount of noise. Typically the raceway will fail first, means this outer raceway or inner raceway, they fail first, and later the ball or the roller. The bearing will give an audible indication when this pit is formed, and it indicates that pitting has begun, means as it proceeds the size of the pit grows, and bearing starts emitting noise and vibration. And if it is not checked at appropriate time and allowed to continue to operate at certain point of time, the entire equipment will fail. Now coming to the bearing specification, as I mentioned, the bearings are mainly specified by the bore diameter, bore size, then the type of bearing, whether it is a single row deep ball bearing, double row deep groove ball bearing, single row angular contact bearing or double row angular contact bearing, roller bearing, double row roller bearing or thrust bearing, that is type. Then diameter series. So as we move from the extra light series to the heavy series, the outside diameter goes on increasing, and at the same time the width also goes on increasing. Similarly, if suppose the bore diameter is kept constant, and in that case if you move from extra light series denoted by 001 or simply 1 to light series, medium or heavy series, the outside diameter and at the same time the width or thickness of the bearing goes on increasing. Let us see in detail in the next slide how this is, so these are specified. This is a typical specification of a bearing by some company. It is a 5-digit number, as you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5-digit number. The first three are for bearing series, and in these three, the first one is for bearing type 0, 1, 2, 3. What is 0, 1, 2, 3? They are given here. 0 means double row angular contact ball bearing, 1 means self-aligned ball bearing, 2 means spherical roller bearing, 3 means tapered roller bearing, so on. 6 means single row deep root ball bearing, 7 single row angular contact ball bearing, 8 cylindrical roller thrust bearing. So the first is type of bearing, which type of bearing it is. Second and third digits or numbers, they represent dimension series. Dimension series means radial bearing are having series from 8, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here I have shown only 4, they can be up to 6. See, width series. Width means where the width of the bearing goes on increasing from 0 to the 6 series, and these are meant for heavy duty. And this digit, third digit, is a diameter series. Diameter series means the diameter, outside diameter of the bearing goes on increasing as you move from the 7 to 4. Again, this is the width series for the thrust bearings. And last two digits, they are the size. They represent the size. Size means the bore diameter of the bearing. Okay. Now let us understand by taking an example here. Say for example, this is a specification by one standard, say a bearing numbered as 6205. What is the meaning of this? 6 means a type of bearing, 6 corresponds to single row deep groove ball bearing, 2 means the width series, so these are light series. And 5 is the bore diameter, means these two digits actually when multiplied by 5 will give the bore size. 5 into 5 means 25 millimeter is the bore diameter bore size of the bearing, and it is applicable only after 5. Up to 4, actual bearing, actual bore size is represented in the catalogs or data books. And another example, 7305. 7 stands for single row angular contact ball bearing, 3 medium series, this one means where the width is much more compared to this, and 05 again the size of the bearing, 05 into 5, 25 millimeters the bore diameter of this bearing. In this figure, the diameter series and the width series are more clear. The outside diameter here goes on increasing when you move from this to this, and also the width of the bearing goes on increasing when you move from 0 to 6. So for different types of bearings, the diameter and the width series are shown. So this is for the dimension series 08, 09, 00, 01, 02, 03, 04. So as you can see, the width of the bearing goes on increasing for different types of bearings. Now, when to use which type of bearing? So this table gives some information regarding selection of a suitable bearing for a suitable application or a situation. Say for example, for low and medium loads, if you have low and medium loads, then go for ball bearing. It may be single row deep groove ball bearing. Then if there are heavy loads and large shaft diameters are there, then go for roller bearings. And if there is possibility of misalignment between the axis of the shafts and the housing, then go for self-aligning ball bearings or spherical roller bearings. For medium thrust loads or axial loads, go for thrust ball bearing. Heavy thrust loads are there, if go for cylindrical roller or thrust bearings. Where there are both components, means both radial and the axial loads are there, you can go for either deep groove ball bearing or angular contact ball bearing or spherical ball bearing. For high speed applications, you can go for deep groove ball bearing, angular contact ball bearing or cylindrical roller bearing. For machine tool spindles, one has to choose either double row cylindrical roller bearing or taper roller bearing. When noise is a critical issue, in that case one has to choose deep groove ball bearing. These are suitable. And this table gives us a little bit more information. So single row deep groove ball bearing can be chosen when a good amount of radial load is there, a fairly thrust load and fair misalignment capability. That means the single row deep groove ball bearing are good for the radial loads, fair for the thrust loads, and also fair for if some misalignment is there. Double row deep groove ball bearing are very very good for the radial loads, also good for thrust loads, and fair if there is misalignment between the shaft axis. Angular contact bearings are very good for radial loads and excellent for the thrust loads, but poor if misalignment is there. Cylindrical roller bearings are excellent for radial loads but poor for thrust loads and fair for misalignment. Needle roller bearings, excellent for radial loads, poor for thrust, and also poor for misalignment existence. Spherical roller bearings are very good, excellent for radial loads, fair or good for thrust loads, and excellent for existence of the misalignment. And finally, tapered roller bearings are excellent for taking the radial loads, excellent for thrust loads, but poor when it comes to misalignment. Now coming to the advantages and disadvantages of the rolling contact bearings. Let us first have a look at the advantages of the rolling contact bearings. First one is the friction resistance and the power consumption are small, the mechanical efficiency is high and easy to start. Once initial effort is very very less. Size standardization, interchangeability, easy to install and disassemble, and also easy to repair. The entire bearing structure is compact, light in weight, and the axial size is also narrower, smaller. High precision, large load and long service life makes these bearings suitable for many applications. Sub bearings have the performance of automatic heart adjustment. It is suitable for mass production. The quality is stable and reliable, and the production efficiency is high. The friction torque of the transmission is much lower than that of the fluid dynamic, means sliding contact bearings. So the friction temperature rise and the power consumption are also low. The actual size is less than the traditional fluid dynamic bearing, that is sliding contact bearing. The combined load of the radial and thrust can be borne simultaneously, means these are suitable to take up simultaneously the radial and the axial loads. Coming to the disadvantages, they make more noise at high speed, low resistant to shock loads, more initial cost is involved, and design of bearing housing is complicated. Finally, coming to the lubrication of the rolling contact bearings, lubrication is absolutely essential to the proper operation of the ball and roller bearings. A proper lubricant will reduce friction between the internal sliding surfaces of the bearing components and reduce or prevent metal to metal contact of the rolling elements with their raceways. Proper lubrication reduces wear and prevents corrosion, ensuring long service lives of the bearings. Now, if oil is used as a lubricant, its advantage is easy to distribute, lubes other components, less drag, easier to drain out and change, better for high temperature. And the disadvantage of using oil as a lubricant is it may leak, then no more lubrication. Means once it leaked, then metal to metal contact will be there. If grease is used as a lubricant, the advantage is remains in space, does not leak out easily, improves sealing and does not require monitoring. Disadvantage of using grease as lubricant is requires more labor to clean out and replenish. High temperature grease is very expensive. So that is about the lubrication of the rolling contact bearings. So that brings us to the end of the part 1. We will see in part 2. Thank you.